Hello, everybody. My name is Jochen Sterk. I'm e-invoicing guy. I'm in one interesting paper. I'm mentioned as a co-author of Zugpferd 2.0. That is an e-invoicing standard we'll tackle later. And I'm also a United Nations e-invoicing expert. So you probably think that must be a great title to put on Elite Partner. And I must be very proud of my business cards. In fact, I am. They look like this. And I usually don't call myself expert. I prefer the title amateur. Because first of all, I don't make money with this stuff. And secondly, it's much easier to make mistakes then. Because if I call myself amateur, I also add a little bit of false humility. For example, this United Nations expert thing is in my free time. It's unpaid and it is remote, of course, so it's not a big deal. And the co-authorship to this Zugpferd 2.0 thing is in one teleconference, I said one sentence or maybe two or three. And I asked them to remove my name, but they didn't quick enough, so we will talk later about the status of Zugpferd 2. My amateurship, I like to do mistakes, so when I call myself amateur, I can make my mistakes much quicker and also cover a little bit my mistakes. I can be more transparent, be less elegant in my code, so I write my open source project because I think that this functionality needs to exist. And code elegance, self-explaining, yes. Elegance, yes, if it's possible, but usually I don't. Usually it's just, it's more important that it works than that it's very elegant. So elegance is not an end in itself. And I can improve. Every time I release a new software version, I can improve. So why am I supporting this Zugpferd standard with my open source software? Why did I start this open source project in the first place? I was writing open source accounting application, and this my open source project called Mustang project is kind of a spin-off of this accounting application. So it's a library. I wanted not to do it monolithic in my software, so I decided to write a Zugpferd library. And then that is why Mustang project was started. And we will talk today about electronic invoices. This is only one third of the agenda. So a little bit about history and Germany, present situation, EDI and stuff, procure to pay. 9 slides plus 7 slides about the future in the European Union or initiated by the European Union and in Germany. A little bit about X-Rechnung, Zugpferd 2. I'll show you how an electronic invoice looks like. And I'll talk a little bit about the challenges. Then as a third part, we will have, I will talk about open standards. About challenges and whatever was there in this project. So, coming to the first part about electronic invoices. In the distant past, we had something in the 1960s, something like EDI, electronic data interchange, started. I have a slide on that, so I'll explain later what this is. And we see some invoice standardization in Germany as of 1977 in this e-invoice field. And then I intentionally left out everything until 2011 because there was not really much happening there. When you want to send invoices until 2011, for example, by email, they had to be digitally encrypted, which wasn't picked up by the market. So. Hardly any relevant electronic invoices were sent. In 2011, that changed because in 2010, the EU had some kind of guideline which said that this doesn't necessarily be the case. Now paper is becoming PDF, or paper became PDF, and now I'll talk about XML. Electronic data interchange. Usually we decide, we distinguish between formats and protocols. So the format defines the meaning of your file. You have something like, if I tell you FF0000, then probably two or three of you might immediately say that's RGB code for red. And that is a format thing. Then you have a protocol which defines sequence addressing, which defines a communication channel. So for example, the HTTP protocol and the HTML format together defines what you can see in your browsers. And for example, if I call you, then the part with the phone is ringing and I don't start talking before you pick up the phone is part of the protocol, and that I then talk in German language is the format of the communication. EDI is typically both, or is always both. So for example, the EDI, EDIFACT format over the AS2 protocol. And usually that's a lot of administrative overhead because there's no generic EDI standard. So typically this is used in companies which process a lot of invoices, something like 100 invoices plus per month. For example, in automobile industry, if you have manufacturers which really build the cars, and then they have in one day they have like 300 radios delivered by Bosch or whatever, then they could think of doing this kind of EDI exchange because it's really it can be an overhead, can also be an administrative overhead. We're talking about contracts which have been seen with 40 pages. So try to make a 40-page contract with Bosch just to agree on the format how you would like to exchange your invoices. There are other cases. I talked with some EDI guys and they said it's relatively smooth. We just pick up the phone, we call the people and we ask them if they support this EDI format and then it works. So it really depends a little bit, but it can be an overhead. Then EDI was, is, and will be allowed in the future. And in general, the situation in Germany is currently we are allowed, we don't need to print digital invoices. That's something I hear sometimes. So if you keep a digital, if you keep the digital original, you actually have to keep the digital original, then it's sufficient. We are allowed to we are allowed to scan paper invoices and dispose the originals. So we can even, if you get too much paper, then you can scan it and you can dispose it. That's under certain restrictions. So your certain conditions have to be met. So for example, you need to certify which you process, who scanned it and who's responsible that everything is scanned and who checked it. And you may not dispose the original until you have the first backup of your electronic copy. Then we don't need any more digital signature in Germany. And if I send you an electronic invoice, you need to consent that you allow me to send you electronic invoices, that you are able to process them. This consent can now be given implied. So if I send you an electronic invoice and you pay it, I assume that you consent with me sending you electronic invoices. And that's then also for the future. But we have this, we have serious restrictions in Germany. This is this GOBD thingy, where you can do a lecture alone. You have to have a revision safe archival of your digital invoices. So it's not enough to put them, I quote, in the file system. You have to have technical and organizational measures, so this TOM kind of thingy, to keep these digital originals safe and secure. And you have to document your process, which is also administrative overhead. There was a survey, and I think like two-thirds of the companies said we don't document our process yet. And there's something like, actually it looks like if the IRS office asks, then you have some days to show them your documented process. So, about PDF. PDF is typically an invoice perspective, it's more or less an image file, for example, a scan, or even if you do it in Word, then you have you still have it as an image, and you also have a top, you have a text layer. It's this text layer is usually invisible, but you can copy and paste from this text layer. This is also, if you do optical character recognition, you also get this text layer top of scanned images. But if you view the invoice, it's just an image. And the idea of Zugpferd is, let's also put some XML information into this PDF file. So this is also an invisible layer. The user who wants to see just the invoice just sees the image, but there's also some additional metadata added for processing the invoice and paying the invoice. So Zugpferd 1 was published in 2014 by the Forum Elektronische Rechnung Deutschland, which is a working group in the AWV, in the Arbeitskreis Wirtschaftliche Verwaltung, which is a Verein, so society. And they used for the XML, for the PDF layer, they used PDF-A, which is an archival version of PDF. It still works in every PDF reader, but it, for example, it embeds all fonts. And for the XML file, they use the customized UNCFACT XML. They have three profiles, which is like levels of completeness. So the most basic information is in the lowest profile, and then you can still add some more structured information. There are supporters like the DATEV, SAP. There are users who are using it in a business-to-business context, like Stork, the Swede company, or Würth. It's famous for screws, but they're doing much more. Deutsche Bahn, then you have, I think it's also in the region here somewhere, is a word I saw a sign. Then business to customer wise, you have, for example, Hilti, E.ON, or Conrad. And we have not seven supporters from 337 countries, but 337 supporters from seven countries. Something like from Arealbank to ZS Computer Service. Why should one put invoice information in an XML file? It doesn't seem to help you very much. What you can do, and you are actually obliged to recalculate your invoices when you get them, at least if you're a business, you can do an automatic recalculation. So you can check that your invoice total amount matches the amount of the items. That's great. You can also have, you can tell if your online banking software supports it, you can tell them, please pay this file, and you don't need to copy and paste this IBAN and whatever anymore. And it's also then you probably get a reference text, a purpose field, so so that the one which you send to your customer. You cannot do an automatic booking of the invoice because the booking does not refer only to the invoice, but refers to the process of consumption and procurement. So it's if you buy something for yourself, then you book it differently than if you buy something and sell it to a customer. Or if you also have some options to choose from. So for example, if you buy small goods around like 500 euros, then you have an option to put everything below 1,000 euro in a pool that's called Pool Alpha in Germany, and the sender of the invoice does not know that you are taking this Pool Alpha option, and even if he or she knows it, you still have some account numbers, for example, for stocks and goods, which the sender cannot possibly know of. So there is no way to really automatically include all the information needed in any invoice to the customer if you don't speak with each other, which would then be EDI case. Then we have something which we call procure to pay, which is the idea that, yeah, basically that's the reason why we put this information in the XML file. Because the idea is that we have, I think I have a slide for that. If you have an if you take the complete process into consideration and you take you get an offer from your supplier, and you send an order to your supplier, and the order and the offer are in your system, in your ERP system, for example, Qvitendo. Hopefully they are somewhere. Is there anybody from Qvitendo in the audience? Okay. Yeah, I already threatened that I'll come to your booth afterwards. You can book your offer and you can book your order and you can also book your delivery. So there's some guy at the entrance with a barcode scanner scanning that really these goods which have been ordered have arrived, and then you can also book this that you got this goods in this amount and quality which was ordered. And if you then can reference from your invoice to the order, and if your invoice matches the order, then and only almost only then you can check, pay, and book this complete stuff, because you already in advance decided how you want to book it once you get the invoice. That sounds like an esoteric kind of thing, which hardly any people does, but it's in fact there are many people getting many invoices. The numbers are astonishingly vague, something like from 4 to 40 billion invoices per year in Germany. And you will see people with, I know somebody who has like 14 employees sitting only in this, only paying invoices. And you have other organizations where you have, there's a medical clinic which has 45 buildings, and invoices can arrive in 38 of them. So if you have a setup where you have a higher volume of invoices, then something like this can help. In particular, if you have some power on your suppliers, so for example, Stork, the sweet company, they ask their suppliers politely to send them their invoices in Zugpferd if possible, which is fine, and they have a great success rate. They have something like over 60%. If you are a nation like Denmark, you can just put out a law, issue a law, and then you say, okay, as of now, everybody sends this stuff in XML. They choose UBA already in 2005, very early, and they have, with this switch to electronic invoices, they have credible savings of 100 million euros a year. And that led to the fact that some other countries said, okay, let's do this as well then. In 2008, Sweden did. In 2010, we see it in Spain and Finland. And in 2014, we see it in Austria and Italy. And that's when the cavalry rolls in. The European Union took some legislation approach already in, they started in 2009, I think, with decent studies and stuff, and until 2014, and in 2014 they came up with a guideline. So that brings me to the future part of this electronic invoicing, and which is the guideline 2014-55 EU, which says, we're talking about business to government, so we're talking about invoices that the government agencies receive. So something like if a government agency, if the boss of the Finanzamt goes to, or if the facility manager of the Finanzamt goes to a Konrad shop and buys a screwdriver for 1,100 euro. The European Union said, okay, there are too many XML things around, we don't really trust this XSLT thingy, so let's agree that we have a maximum of 5 syntaxes, maximum 5 formats, and we want a format which is also suitable for B2B use, and we want that the nations decide as of which minimum amount they want to have electronic invoices. Ironically, there's a maximum minimum amount or a minimum amount, I don't know. So there's amount as of which all need to accept electronic invoices, but they can go lower. And the nations can decide whether they want to require or only have it as optional to send them electronic invoices. So you can send electronic invoices to everybody, and in some countries you have to. And then the standardization organization of the European Union is CEN, which is in Germany it's a DIN, in the European Union it's a CEN, internationally it's the ISO. And the CEN then had a more detailed document, the EN 16931 standard, which says, okay, maximum 5 syntaxes was set, we take 3. We take EDI, we take UBL, which is an XML format, or we take UNCFACT XML. And we have a kind of a core invoice, which is mandatory for all B2G invoices. And then the TTAs start. Because this core invoice said, okay, you need to specify a country and an electronic email address you're sending this invoice to. But in the German Umsatzsteuergesetz, you have something like an invoice you can only use for your VAT deduction if you have a street address on it. So there are additional national requirements for these invoices, which are called CIUS, so core invoice usage specifications. And in the German CIUS, there's also, it's optional, but it's there, Skonto, so cash discount, which is really unusual on a European level, but in Germany it's quite usual to give your client a rebate if they pay early. The EU also said something like, and all nations implement from 2017 to 2020. So in Germany, we have a first CIUS, which is the X-Rechnung. The X-Rechnung says, the X-Rechnung is defined for the XML format UBL, and it's defined for the XML format UNCFACT. And then we have the E-Rechnungsgesetz and the E-Rechnungsverordnung, which says that the minimum amount as of which you have to have the invoice electronically is only 1,000 euro, which covers around 95% of the invoices. And it's optional as of November 2018 and mandatory as of November 2019. So as of, I think, 27th of November 2019, all of these suppliers have to send electronic invoices to the state, to the country, and to their authorities. All suppliers for German authorities and some other countries as well, but that's actually quite a number, because we were talking about like 300 named known suspects for Zugpferd. There are probably a lot more, probably far over 1,000, which because there are many which are not known. But if we talk about 300 where we know for sure that they support or want to support Zugpferd, we're talking about 300,000 suppliers which are affected by this, or probably around 300,000 suppliers which are affected by this law. Because in one newspaper article, I found the number 300,000. So the X-Rechnung is either you take one XML format or you take the other XML format. So the X-Rechnung is defined for both XML formats. And if you show this chart to some Zugpferd guy, the Zugpferd guy says, sorry, I can't help, but what I see is this. I have XML and I put a PDF layer below it. So that's why Zugpferd 2 is in the making. It's not yet published, unfortunately. Actually, it's delayed. It's heavily delayed. But it is it's adopted, so it's clear what will be in there. It's not yet completely published, but there is a public preview of it. It's still by the Pferd, and they took out all the customizations of the XML, so it's now vanilla UNCFACT XML. We have two more profiles, which is largely owed to a cooperation with France, because France adopted Zugpferd 2 as Factory X1, and they also put it in the list of their allowed formats in their portal called Chorus Pro, or I can't pronounce it. Do we have any French people here? Okay. Nevertheless, there is a EN6931 profile, which, the XML in the end of a Zugpferdrechnung in the EN6931 profile matches the UNCFACT version of a X-Rechnung. There are ongoing discussions about intellectual property, which is the official reason why Zugpferd is delayed, because Zen published EN16931 and it is not available for free, like in free beer, so you have to pay for the standard, and there are some discussions. And there are some Zugpferd open source libraries and tools. Factor X, for example, has published a Python library. Konig is a Java and .NET library, open source, GPL for Zugpferd. And my Mustang project is a Java library and tool for Zugpferd. And I show this is a small overview about the B2C, B2B, and B2G ishness of these different standards. I tend not to put X-Rechnung in compatible for business-to-customer use because it's an XML file and I don't know of any reader at all. At least not available for a customer, not to speak of open source. So, let's show you some kind of electronic invoice. If somebody thinks that must look very different, very similar to a PDF file, then this is completely correct, because if you say, I want to, actually we have problems that some people already get Zugpferd invoices and they don't notice because it looks like a PDF file. It is a PDF file. So this is Acrobat Reader, and I don't know if you can see, it looks and behaves like the usual PDF file, PDFA file, that is this little notice over here. And then you can select text, which is this text layer I mentioned, which is also still PDF and not related to Zugpferd. And if you notice this little noopsie, you will see that there is an embedded XML file. And I could save it here, but I can even make it more complicated, so I can use my software to save it. You can also count how many invoices you have from a directory with this thing, or how many invoices have XML information. And then we have this Zugpferd-invoice.xml, and if I go like this, you will see that this is looks and feels and is a XML document. So, for example, I now make a small mistake. You also, if you remember, the amount was something like 571. That's a grand total and due payable amount. If you do scanning of invoices and automatic processing, then this is the first notion maybe to take the biggest amount and assume that this is the amount to be paid, which is not always true if you have payments before. So if you have a small payment in advance, then this is no longer the case. And there are at least two suppliers which send you Zugpferd files if you give them paper copies, because they do the recognition for you. And then you can, that's basically, you can use this to extract, or you can use this to combine. I have a small Blanco document over here, which is the whole thing without the XML structure. This one is a PDF A1 format, and Zugpferd defines PDF A3, which has nothing to do with the DIN A3 paper format, but it's just that PDF A3 allows embedding other files and PDF A1 does not yet. So my library puts a label, this is PDF A3, on a PDF A1 file, which is completely valid because it's backward compatible. So if I say I want to create a Zugpferd file from this Blanco and my Zugpferd invoice, and I want to do it in Zugpferd 1, then you get this kind of result. And if you open it, then you still have the whole thing with this Zugpferd invoice.xml in brackets with Zugpferd 2. This is called factor minus x.xml. That's how you can optically distinguish them. And now I've written a small validator, which is called, which will become part of Mustang project, and it's still called Zuf. So if I say that Zuf should validate this invoice, then I hopefully don't get many errors. Zuf is standing on top of the shoulders of giants, so Zuf uses an open source PDF validator called VeraPDF and Schematron, which is either provided by Schematron is like a, if you know XML, you know that a schema file defines how what is allowed in this XML, and Schematron is even more tight. So Schematron can check even better the XML files. And in part of Zugpferd, it's very good if you not only adhere to the schema file, but also to the Schematron file. There's an official Schematron for Zugpferd 1, and there's the EN16931 Schematron from the ZEN, which is used in Zuf if you have a Zugpferd 2 file. So VeraPDF doesn't find any errors in the PDF, and there are no errors in the XML. And if I try my fancy little invoice.zugpferd.pdf, which I faked with this little error, then I hope that it tells me that I did something wrong. This is really like, it used to take 12 minutes, now it takes something like 12 seconds, so for me this is really easy going now. So we have this feedback, so we can check them, which is important if you want to publish your own software which writes Zugpferd files, or even if you only get invoices and you want to check them before you process them. And I think there was a lot of demand for this validator. Actually, there was a lot of demand for, there are two proprietary validators. There was a lot of demand also for an open source validator. And I assume that they want to put it in their toolchain. So they want to run automated tests when they do new releases of their software. They want to have a validator they can install on site and which then runs through this file. That's it. You can also have a look at Zugpferd 2, which really isn't much different. Which is this sample file, and as mentioned, it's now called Factor X, and you can also validate it in Zuf. And this is now even worse. Oh, cool. Proprietary software. It looks very similar. There are only the root element changed, the file name changed, and certain things changed, and now the order is important. If you need to know the details, there's a Mustang project. There's this e-invoices page where I lay down the history and background information and the laws and the newspaper article I mentioned and some other things. So it's like a complete book in one HTML page, which is what you shouldn't do from user perspective, but in my case, I wanted to do that. There's a timeline how Zugpferd developed and which countries, when, and however. And there's also a map, and then that is a UNCFAC map, a e-invoice readiness indicator. And there's a map like which companies became when, like accepted invoices and stuff. If I don't manage to scare you off enough with this speech, then you can still get scared of this electronic invoices stuff at home. So let's continue to the learnings. Open standards. There's a definition of an open standard by the European Interoperability Framework, which says it's adopted and maintained by not-for-profit organizations. AWV is one of those not-for-profit organizations, and they have defined an open process how to about the governance of the format. So that's checked for Zugpferd and for many other formats as well, for UBL as well, and also for UNC-FACT XML. It's available freely or at nominal charge. You have to put your email address when you want to download the Zugpferd standard, but specification. But yeah, then go for Zugpferd 2.0. The public preview is still public, so you can download that from the mentioned page. And it's a IP royalty free, means that if patents are covered, then these patents need to be available for free. And I think in this case, there are no patents, and there are no constraints on the reuse of this standard, which is also checked for Zugpferd. Actually, it's the case for many of them. In the case of PDF, we even have it, PDF specification is freely available because Adobe donated it, more or less. PDFA is a different case. You have to pay for it. It's something like 200 euros, at least PDFA 3, and I think also PDFA 1, which is a little bit of, I don't know anymore if I would call that a nominal charge, but let's call it a nominal charge, then it's still an open standard. Then we have Zugpferd and Factor X, which is open standard, and we have X-Rechnung and OpenTrans. I would put a question mark there. X-Rechnung has been published for free with no patents, but it is by a governmental body, let's call it like this, where there is some governance about contributing, but it's just because they have to, their aim is to support it for the countries and for the authorities. So it wouldn't make sense to have other people decide what's part of the X-Rechnung. There's also nice, optically nice and appealing and very simple and straightforward XML standard called OpenTrans. I'm not really sure if the publisher is a not-for-profit organization, probably it is, but I don't know anything about the governance, so I would skip that. And OpenTrans, despite very elegant, elegance is not an end in its own, is, as far as I know, not yet covered by this fancy EN16931, so probably not eligible for governmental use or for use in invoices to governments in Europe. Then we have some open standard organizations like the DINS and ISO I mentioned, the OASIS and the UNC-FACT. There is some of these standard organizations are by law responsible for some standards. So this is this de jure kind of thingy. Then there's the interesting question by which law and which standard. But DINSEN and ISO definitely are. UASIS is not, and UNC-FACT is. That's a real interesting topic. I recommend my mustangproject.org e-invoices page. There's a nice little report on the differences between OASIS and UNC-FACT, which is really interesting to read if you like this sublime humor kind of thingy, because in the end, UBL was published by OASIS after being tasked from UNC-FACT. So UNC-FACT said, let's do something invoice-wise, and it took so long that in the end, OASIS said, okay, we now publish what we have, which is, there's still some kind of friction between these, not between the organizations, but between certain individuals and between users and standards. It's really interesting because you have to admit that UNC-FACT apparently did not really move that fast, probably, if you read this report. But it's ridiculous to some people put it as an argument. You shouldn't use UBL because OASIS is not a de jure standard organization, which is just funny. Then you have standardization fees. So if you want to, if you're a commercial company and you go to these bodies, they have experience in open standards and in standardization, so they can help you and they are trustful and it's a marketing argument. So they will basically charge you if you go to the DIN, CEN or ISO. OASIS, I don't think, and UNCFACT, I know that they don't charge you, but you have to be in line with their project. So you cannot just say standard my way to breed doves, or I don't know, my espresso machine. The interesting thing, that's also the reason why DIN was involved in a very early stage in Zugpferd. Rumors accordingly, there was really a price tag. So DIN said, let's make it a DIN standard. It will cost something like this. And the other sponsors of the Zugpferd standard didn't pay for it. That's then EN 16931, someone came from EU level. Then you have participation fees, so you have to pay if you are for OASIS membership, you have to pay for ISO membership, and usually you have to, if you download a DIN rule, usually you have to pay. It's in the, I think the Beuth Verlag does the marketing or the selling for the DIN. So Zugpferd had no funding at all. So it's not that millions of taxpayers' monies went into Zugpferd. Contrary maybe to X-Rechnung, where some Planstellen might have been allocated or used for that kind of stuff. But Zugpferd had really a sound €0 funding. There was a little bit of administrative help. So if they needed a meeting room, that was granted. But there was not that anybody put taxpayers' money on that kind of thing. There are interestingly very few available algorithms for invoices. The UN did a very big one, which consists of, I think, about 1 million attributes. And then on European level, there was this CII, always means cross-industry invoice. And then on European level, they said that's way too much. Let's limit it down to 50,000 attributes, which is this message user guide, which was then more or less agreed upon. Does anybody of you know any authoring tools for XML or for Schematron, maybe? Because if you know, let me know. I don't know any. In the end, Zugpferd used the proprietary one. That's a little bit of an issue. And there were a lot of political discussions, and if I talk of political discussions, I mean intra-project political discussions, so not discussions from the government or whatever, but it is, there's a line, it's a walk on the border. So if you do too much political discussions, then you don't get anything released, see the UNCFACT XML, which took years and years. And if you do too little political discussions, you have yet another standard nobody wants to agree to. So you get too much fragmentation. And then in the end, X-Rechnung didn't decide on one format, which I personally think it's more or less a weakness and not a strength of the X-Rechnung, because you have to support both formats then. And I think it's better to decide clearly for one format if you're doing a format, but that's probably also political. Then, of course, there were a lot of desiderata. I'm not even a member of the FAIRT, so I'm an independent open source project commenting on how the Zugpferd process worked, which in the end had a great result and worked great. But there were many people who had many comments and many requests, and first of all, everybody wanted their format to be used, but apparently there were many formats. In the beginning, they did a survey on, I think they found 47 competing formats. Some of them they now are now replaced with Zugpferd. For example, there was one in the automotive industry which had a format where you had an XML file, and in the XML file you had a base64 encoded PDF file, which is kind of the other way around. Don't laugh, we're talking about mainly about politics, which is more important, the PDF for the XML. Then, of course, they want many people wanted to have commitments. Until when will you do this? If you don't have funding, it's hard to enter any commitments. Then you have the legislation, which doesn't really rely on initiatives. They have a SEN, and so they use a SEN. It's hard to say, okay, we did something for free. Why don't you use it? Because they say, if you're not there anymore tomorrow, then we lose. Then there was a request for a reference validator, often heard request for a reference validator. We don't give a on reference validator because we have two proprietary ones and we had to replace one of those with the open source one. And it's really cost intensive to have an open source validator, or it's not cost intensive. You basically need one idiot like myself to do it. If you have some basics where you can base upon. For example, the situation is very similar to Vera PDF, which is this open source PDF validator. PDF also doesn't have a reference validator, and Vera PDF is a very great project with a great outcome and a real strict validator, which I like very much. And it's embeddable, as you can see, because I'm using it embedded. So it's a great work, and they also but it was done in a project, one of six deliverables of a project, but that was more than €1 million. So you need, if you want to enforce something in open source, you might have to pay for this as well. Then there was a request. We have some pragmatic and a dogmatic section of Zugpferd users. So the dogmatic takes every word for very strict, and the pragmatic section, Hauptsache es funktioniert, so mainly it works. And they wanted to have a not so strict validator. And you have industry requirements, the different industries, so the unterschiedlichen Branchen. They have different requirements vis-a-vis electronic invoices. For example, if you are in the if you sell electricity, you have to tell the people about your electricity mix. So you have to tell the people how much percent of this electricity was gained from renewable sources. Or if you sell physical goods, then you have to probably you have to also tell the people if you want to about the waste. So if you sell electronic devices, you have to have or if you sell anything that's plastic, you have to include in your invoice something like, we take this back. And we're talking about archival duties where like 10 years is basically set. So if you publish a standard, then 10 years later you still have to support that standard. So Zugpferd is made of open specification. Yeah. Could be better, but whatever. No open tools, or let's say there was open tools for creating Zugpferd files and open tools for validating Zugpferd files and libraries and stuff not yet in Perl. I think the Kivitendo might be interested for that. There's this open validator, and before I started the validator, I started a corpus, so a collection of Zugpferd files from the wild and crafted ones, to check if they can be read, or if somebody wants to check if the readers work, and also to check if the validators, how good are the validators. Interestingly, usually it's like one validator supports this set and the other validator supports this set, and there's an intersection, a big intersection, and usually they don't contradict each other. But still, the people already complain if validator A finds it and validator B doesn't find it. which is interesting because they could just stick to the stricter one in that case. There was by the GFEC, which is the IT part of the DIN, they had the Zugpferd validation for Zugpferd 1. Then we had from the company Intarsis is a proprietary checker. Then we have a Konik.io, which is one of the Java libraries, open source validation component, which nobody calls validator because it doesn't check the PDF. Then we have a new version. We had a new version of the Intarsis checker, which was much better and suddenly was better than the GFEC one. Then I came up with this corpus idea. Then we have this GFEC prototype for version 2, Zugpferd version 2. And then I came up with this TUF kind of thingy, which is composed, as mentioned, of this Zen, Schematron, and Vera PDF, which is, by the way, similar situation in the PDF lager like we have in the Zugpferd lager. Then we have some potential prejudices, which is my usual complaints before we open the question and answer round. Some people say e-invoicing open source software only helps the big enterprises who should be able to afford to pay anyway. Yes, maybe sometimes, but it's also usable for the small companies which have to, which sometimes may have to submit an electronic invoice. And even organizations are people in the end. The D in Zugpferd is not necessarily always Germany because factor X, and if there's anybody interested, if there's a sound interest from other countries, we can arrange some meetings. And open source software, of course, you have people who think that somebody else will fix it for free and find it for free. And there's also some kind of hesitation to embark in interim technologies in terms of probably in 50 years we don't need Zugpferd anymore because then we really have some XML or EDI kind of stuff. And yeah, that's probably true. But the question is if this will be in 50 days or if it will be in 50 years. And I say until we needed to introduce electronic invoices, structured electronic invoices, which still the people can read in the reader of their choice, until it is settled and then someone maybe a pure native format can come. And then, of course, you have people asking, why didn't you choose standard XYZ as a basis, XML standard XYZ as a basis? Then you have this, if we can't enforce support, we should not use it. There's also commercial support available for Zugpferd in the meantime. And if there are errors in the software, that's a typically slide. I guess some other people have this comment as well. Users usually say or think somebody else will report it, somebody else will fix it, somebody else will fix it better. I couldn't even try myself. And the girl or guy who fixes it will also be somehow compensated because either he or she then feels better or because they're earning money with it anyway. So I don't earn money with Zugpferd. I had one donation of €100 and I wrote an article which was paid, but that's it in the last, like, I'm in it for 4 years now. So, do we have any questions, or did I just, thanks for coming in the morning and a very boring sounding talk besides. Was it so boring? Okay. Do you have any questions regarding electronic invoices? Yes? When will Zugpferd 2.0 be released? The Zugpferd guys say in time. In time could mean November 2018, but probably more means before November 2019. I'm relatively close to them. I go to their conferences. But it's hard to find out what is the real problem. It's politics, I guess. I don't know. I would like to know as well, but there's this, on my boring internet page, there is this a link to the public preview of the Zugpferd 2 available, which you can use to start off with Zugpferd invoices. Any other questions? Yes? Yeah. Preferred way to transmit electronic invoices to the recipients. Zugpferd, I think, officially doesn't have one. It, in the end, it turns out that many are using email. But email is, then you have a data protection issue. And the other part is, maybe the bigger part is with a HTTPS download on a portal. If you have your invoices on a portal where the customer can log in and download his or her invoices with HTTPS, it's more secure. And in particular, you know when he or she downloaded it, which is interesting, because if it's not really only about this invoices, but also for credit memos, because the invoice, you can more or less deduct the VAT Schuld, die Umsatzsteuerschuld fällt an when you transmit the invoice, or actually when you do the work, usually. And with credit memos, your value-added taxes are due when the recipient receives the invoice. So you need to know when he or she receives it. On a personal side, I couldn't, I'm a coder, so I couldn't leave my fingers off the keyboard, so I wrote a little implementation in XMPP. So basically the WhatsApp is using it, I think. It's an instant message protocol. I wrote a little proof of concept to do to transmit and receive Zugpferd invoices, which works, but it's really really going then into the EDI domain. Usually it's HTTPS, which the people use in the world. Okay, any other questions? Yes. Time. The last question. Somebody up for the last question? In this case, there is no last question. Thank you a lot, and have a nice time at the FOSCON. And thanks to the FOSCON team and whatever, to the Hochschule in Rhein-Sieg. Thank you.